or a curse. That means the Bible says in the book of Proverbs that the life and death are in the power of the tongue, and he who knows how to use it shall eat the fruit thereof. Am I like that? That means the tool, the tongue that God has given you, and me, that is kind of a rudder of a ship of your life that defines your destiny, that creates a future, that creates wealth for you, that creates health for you, that creates prosperity for you, that creates peace for you, that creates shalom in your environment, is the same tool that God has given for you to charter your course from the beginning of your salvation for you to live eternity in the presence of Yeshua the Messiah. Amen? So in the power of your tongue, you have got death and you have got life. The choice is ours. You may be born again, you may be water baptized, you may be Holy Ghost filled. You are full of the Spirit of God. You are a prophet of God. You are a worshiper of God. You are a man and a woman who loves Jesus. You are a man and a woman who wants to adore Jesus. You never miss a Friday service. You never miss an evening service. You never miss a fasting and praying times. You are there in the presence of God, but yet you can still shape your destiny. Yet you have the power to shape your future. Yet you have the power to align yourself in a way that God's word has called you to be. So a lot of time we hear lots today about the right of free speech. You know, I come from a democratic nation. And so many of you who are seated here come from democratic nation. And in democracy, we have the right of speech, the freedom of speech. You know, I always say the freedom of speech does not mean freedom what you want to do, but freedom what you ought to do. And that's what real and true freedom is all about. Freedom is not what you want to do, but freedom is what you ought to do. That means there are parameters of the definition of freedom within democracy. Are you with me? A lot of time we think, in a democracy, we have got the right to speak, the right to express our opinion, the right to, you know, say, the right to, you know, do anything. And a lot of time, I find that, you know, in our democratic nations, not in autocratic nations, but in democratic nations, we are so liberal in our speech that we tear down our prime ministers and our presidents and everybody else. But that's not what freedom is actually all about. Freedom is that, yes, that man who is operating in the office of the Prime Minister is meant to be revered and respected and talked honorably and respectfully, though you may be a democratic in your thinking and free in your speech, it does not mean that you will derogate him, make fun of him, poke jokes on him, and pull him down. Are you with me? So, the Bible is very clear about that, and we need to understand that the tongue that we have in a free world, the tongue has been given to the free church by free Jesus, so that by free salvation, because the tongue has been given, A, to glorify God, to worship God, and also to build up the creation of God that is created in his own image. That is man and woman who is created in the very image of God. God anticipates and expects that you, as a free church that has been bought by the blood of Jesus, ransom was completely paid so that you and I will build up one another in the holy faith. Are you with me? And that's why it is imperative. Today, relationships are at peril. Churches stand at a point of division. You know, unity of the body of Christ is divided. You know why? Just because one tool of your body, one organ of your body, is not under the control of the Holy Spirit. And a lot of time we cause death, we cause wounds, we cause hurts to ourselves and to our relationships all around us, that we are unable to cope up with our scenarios in our one-to-one and our daily relationships with one another. And my dear brothers and sisters, the power of the tongue is so powerful that it can either make you or break you. Are you with me? Whether you have got a small child, whether your child is in your womb, You can build or break the child's personality when the child is inside of your womb, and that's been medically proven. What do you speak to your child? How do you speak to your child? How do you speak to your spouse in your relationship? How do you speak to your children? Are you in a process of building up a relationship, or you're tearing it down? You can just do it by the soul of your spirit. And the soul of your spirit and the soul of your body is your tongue. It is like a double-edged sword. You can kill yourself and you can kill everybody around you with the sharp arrows of your tongue. And so we need to understand, you know, that we are reminded in the Word of God that we must remember that our tongue is important for us to stay on course of our salvation, to stay on course of our faith and run the race patiently so that we'll achieve the crown that God has in store for you and for me. Turn with me to the book of Titus, chapter 2, verses 15 to chapter 3, verse 11. And let's read it. These things speak and exhort and reprove with all authority. Titus is also a protege of Apostle Paul, as Timothy was. And here he is writing to him, these things speak, so it means you need to read Titus 1 and Titus 2 in completion, so that you can, with all authority, speak those things. And he says, these things speak and exhort and reprove with all authority. Let no one disregard you. Remind them to be subject to rulers, to authorities, to be obedient, to be ready for every good deed, to malign no one. I like that word, malign, no one. To be peaceable, gentle, showing every consideration for all men. I did not say only to the pastor. It did not say only to the Christians. It said all men, say all men.
Amen.
That means people who are not of your kind. People who have difference of opinion. People, those who are not in agreement with you. People, those who do not have the same belief system like yours. That's what Paul is talking to Titus and giving him an apostolic vision to Titus how to run the church and how to do the work of the ministry. So he says here, verse 3, for we also once were foolish ourselves. I like that. So you understand the freedom of speech when we are reading these passages of scripture. And you'll understand where to draw the line and where not to draw the line. And it's a great dilemma whether we should speak or we should not speak or how to speak. We are going to learn all these things today. The art of communication. Are you with me? Alright. For we also once were foolish ourselves, disobedient, deceived, enslaved to various lusts and pleasures, spending our life in what? Malice and envy, hateful, hating one another. But when the kindness of God our Savior and His love for mankind appeared, I like that, when Jesus appeared, He saved us, not on the basis of our works, not on the basis of what you do, right? It says He saved us not on the basis of deeds which we have done, mind you, in righteousness. He clarifies it. Alright? You have got good intention, you have done works of righteousness, but you were not saved by your good intention or by your works of righteousness. It was only because of the mercy of Yeshua you and I were saved. Hallelujah. So thank you, Lord, for your mercy. It was not by your works. Are you with me? Alright, let's go there. It says there further, but according to His mercy, by the washing of regeneration and renewing by the Holy Spirit, whom he poured out upon us richly through Jesus Christ our Savior. Now he did not stop at mercy, but he continued. And I like that, and I have highlighted it for you. He continued, that means A, you were saved by mercy. Then the work did not stop there. Hallelujah. I love my Jesus. He does not only save you and leave you in the middle of the ocean to struggle for your salvation, but he starts with you and ends with you, making you a finished product of the Son of Jesus. Hallelujah. He doesn't leave you like a splintered wood in the middle of the ocean that you now figure it out on your own. I brought you out and now you figure it out on your own. No, sir. When God started with mercy, he says, then, comma, by the washing of regeneration and renewing by the Holy Spirit. And I'm going to focus your attention on these three words. Are you with me? Whom he poured out upon us richly through Jesus Christ our Savior, so that being justified. I like that. Being, say being.
Being.
Past, present, and continuous tense. You were justified yesterday, you're being justified today, and you will be justified tomorrow. Say, I'm justified. Say, I'm sanctified. And I'm glorified with Jesus. I am a finished product in the presence of God. That's how God sees you. But you're a work in progress. God has brought you out of darkness. And now he positions you under his grace, his mercy, and then he pours his waters of baptisms, of the Word and of the Holy Spirit and of the Word, and cleanses you. I like that. Gives you a bath. Hallelujah. Takes you to a bathtub, soaks you in. Hallelujah. Cleans you up, makes you pure, and dedicates you for holy use unto the Lord God Almighty. Isn't that amazing? I get excited. You know why? Because the holiness is his prerogative for me. It is, he says, I will make my people holy. And I like that. When God takes the responsibility of making me holy, I need to be rest assured that by the works or my deeds, I will not be saved. But by my presentation of my spirit, soul, and body, he will make me perfect. That means availability to God's presence of your spirit, soul, and body is of paramount importance. That is why we come to church. That is why we gather together for life group meetings. That is why we gather together for corporate fasting and prayer. Why? Because whenever an opportunity is thrown, I present myself to the Lord so that he will have the capacity to make me pure and clean and holy and make me exactly like Jesus. Hallelujah. That is why Hebrews 10:25 says what? Forsaking not the assembling of the saints, as some have become habitual to. What is the habit of some people? Oh, church, we'll think about it. Oh, pastor, you know, pastor has to anyway write a good morning note on ABC in the morning and wake you up to smell some coffee and tell you to come to church. That's pastor's job. So some people have become used to or become habitual. That's what Hebrews 10:25 says. That they do not want to come for the fellowship. But there is a power of koinonia and the power of fellowship that makes us clean and that fans away the sins of the world. That's the power of koinonia. When you dwell together with anointed men and women of God, when you come in the fellowship of the saints, it makes you holy. And I give you a classic example. Saul had fallen from grace, and Saul had no spirit of God. But when he showed himself among the prophets, the spirit of the prophet came back to him, and he also started to prophesy. That's the power of koinonia. That's the power of fellowship. Why would any Christian be away from the house of God and be reminded to come to church? I don't understand. So the Bible says in Hebrews 10:25, forsaking not the assembling of the saints. Why? Because when you are in the fire of God, you catch When you're in the anointing of God, you catch the anointing of God. When you're in the presence of His glorious manifested glory, you catch that glow and glory of Yeshua, and you start to radiate His glory. You go back out charged and recharged with the presence of the Holy One of Israel. So when you step out into the evil world, you attract favor of God. You attract glory of God. You attract blessings of God. You attract clients. You attract business deals. You attract bonuses. You attract door opens. Why? Because you have met with God, and now you don't go in your strength, by the power of your deeds that you have done in righteousness, but you are under the mercy, under the washing, under the fellowship, under the power of His anointing. And that is what makes the difference. That's why it sets you apart. Why? Because, hey, man, these guys were with Jesus. Correct? Hey, they are different. You know why? Because they have spent time with Jesus. And because they have spent time with Jesus, they are superhumans. When it comes to the workplace, they attract the favor and the blessing of Yeshua. So what is it saying? Let's go back. Verse 8. This is a trustworthy statement. And concerning these things, I want you to speak confidently, so that those who have believed God will be careful to engage in good deeds. Wow. Those who have believed God. Haven't you believed in God? Yes or no?
Yes.
Some are confident, some are not. Do you believe in Yeshua?
Yes.
Praise God. That's right. Then that's sure. Okay, response. Further, these things are good and profitable for men. I like that. Say good and profitable. Say the word I'm receiving today is good and profitable to me. Come on. When you slip to the natural, you didn't go back anymore. You'll go back changed. You'll go back with the glory. Your bondages will be destroyed. Your shackles will be broken and changed. And your fetters will be cut in Jesus' name. You go free there. That's what God is interested in. Freedom. Not what you want to do, but freedom what you ought to do in the parameters of God's word. Alright, let's go further. Verse 9. But avoid foolish controversies and genealogies, and strife and disputes about the law, for they are unprofitable and worthless. Then it says, verse 10, reject a factious man after a first and a second warning, knowing that such a man is perverted and is sinning, being self-condemned. A factious man, a man who divides the truth of God's word and uses it for his own glory or for his own belly. Are you with me? That man, you should mark and keep him away. Right? Why? Because he's self-condemned. That's what the Bible says. Now, when Paul was writing this letter to Titus, he was sitting in a Roman jail. And he was in a dungeon. He wrote these words to Titus. Years had passed, and Paul has seen and lived the pain of Roman imprisonment. Yet, his desire to see the church grow into the mature image of Jesus Christ rests at the forefront of his letter. I like that. Can you imagine? He's in prison and giving apostolic instruction to Titus, who's outside in the free world. I like that. He was in prison, but yet he's writing to the church of Philippi in Philippians 4:4, rejoice in the Lord always. And again I say rejoice. Wow. Can you imagine the mental state of Paul? It was not about him, it was about the church. He has come to a place of maturity that it was no selfish ambition, it was no matter of his belly, it was no matter of his comfort, it doesn't matter whether he's in the jail, but the maturity of the church was foremost in his letters.
Amen.
See the mental maker. How do you get that mental maker? How can he write such fantastic letters to to the church outside when you are in prison. He could have written, please pray, brother. Please, can you share the time, brother? Can you fast and pray for me that I'll be released from the jail? Nowhere is he beseeching the church. Have you read all the letters of Paul? Nowhere has he beseeched the church, pray for my liberty, or pray for my deliverance, or pray for my victory. Today, many Christians are in that bracket of pray for me, pastor, pray for me, brother, or pray for my marriage, or pray for my children, or pray for my finances. Hey, guys. Paul is interested about the maturity of the church. And we, as mature church, must also have a perspective of a mature body of Christ, wherever we are. It's not about me, it's about you. It's not about us, it's about them.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That's what God is calling us as a church of amazing grace. Amen.
Yes.
So 18 years now and moving forward. And many of us, Brother John, 10 years, many of us are 18 years old in this church. I was seeing our oldies picture the other day, Brother Sam posted. The oldies of our church. And we liked him. You know why? Man, we started small. Very small. But let me tell you one thing. Each and every you have become a stalwart in the kingdom of God. Each and every you have become a leader in your own right. That you not only lead yourself, but you lead many others to Christ. You are now interested in the maturity of others. It's not about you.
Yes.
That's the mindset of Paul. In the prison, he's writing to a free church.
Yes.
Are you in your prison today? And are you so seasoned in God that you can pray for your brothers and sisters outside who are equally bound in chains and fetters? Or can you bring liberty and freedom to them in the mighty name of Jesus? Or it's all about you? All right, let's go further. There's a potential downside for this constitutional right and for the Christian. The downside frequently arises when we take the attitude that we will call it as we see it, and in doing so, take no prisoners and show no mercy with our tongue. When you say we are democratic and have the freedom and the right to express my opinion, this will often create the dilemma of how does one express their constitutional right, speak what is obviously true, and yet maintain a standard Paul describes in Titus 3:13. The freedom of speech often clashes with the understanding of Paul's instruction. He says in 3:13 of Titus, to malign, that is speak evil of no one, to be peaceable, gentle, showing every consideration for all men. My dear brothers and sisters, God understands the frailty of man. And he also understands the frailty of your tongue. Come on. God made you. And God made your tongue. So he understands what is the characteristics of your tongue. He knows it. And he mentions it very clearly there. Right? And he understands the sinful and destructive nature of a man's tongue. Apostle James, inspired by the Holy Ghost, expresses God's understanding of man's tongue. In James chapter 3, verse 8, what does he say? He says, verses 5 onwards, see how great a forest a little fire kindles. And the tongue is what? What is it written there? Tongue is a?
Fire.
Tongue is what?
Fire.
Fire is inside. See, my tongue is my fire. Now the issue is whether it's burning or not. And how it is burning. Alright? A word that is all iniquity. This is how God sees. The tongue is so set among our members that it defiles the whole body. And sets on fire the course of nature, and is set on fire by hell. Man, if a man's tongue is set on fire, literally from the pit of hell, how can a man be delivered of his tongue? It's a question, right? Oh Lord, your word says, my tongue is set in the pit of hell. Right? Our out of this tongue, okay, I curse the people around me who are made in the image of God. I curse my own spouse, curse my own children, curse my finances, and no wonder you've got no money in your pocket. Are you with me? You curse the prosperity of God. Oh, God never said, tell me which apostle was rich. And Abraham was rich. You have got Abraham's faith. Right? We should understand in context the word of God. And so we read here, for every kind of beast and bird of reptile and of creature of the sea is tamed and has been tamed by mankind, but no man can tame the tongue. I don't say it, the word of God is saying. When God's word, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, says that no man can tame tongue, it means we need somebody else's help. Yes. Hello?
Yes.
Am I right?
Yes.
It means I need somebody else's help to tame my tongue, to bridle my tongue.
Yes.
And so you do. Right? So how did the Christian exercise his opinion of right and wrong without breaching the standard expected of us by God? It's a big question. The answer is found in verse 3 when Paul reminds us that we were all once in the same state of ignorance about God's love for his creation. God has always loved the sinner and hated the sin. Isn't that beautiful? Paul goes on to declare in verse 4 of a passage that we read, but when the kindness of God our Savior and his love for mankind appeared, he saved us not on the basis of deeds which we have done in righteousness, but according to his mercy, by the washing of regeneration and renewing by the Holy Spirit, whom he poured out upon us richly through Jesus Christ our Savior, so that being justified by his grace, we would be made heirs according to the hope of eternal life. God's standard of love requires us to show the same amount of mercy that he demonstrated to us. If you say, I'm forgiven, by the grace and mercy of Jesus, I will also forgive my enemies by the same grace and mercy, the way my sins were forgiven. Hello? That's what it means. My spouse I will forgive. My children I will forgive. I will have mercy upon my brothers and sisters the way God has had mercy on me. And that's the level of maturity that we can come to, that we can take a high path and live in an arena of love and forgiveness and lead a life that is so in the image of Yeshua the Messiah. Are you with me? Herein lies the danger of a free tongue. We can have the right to say anything, but should we? Is the question. I'm free. I have the right to say anything, but should I? The question. Furthermore, does the fact that something may be true justify the words that proceed out of our mouths? Again, the question. I'm throwing these questions for us to unshackle our thinking about freedom of speech. Are you with me? And aligning our thinking in accordance with the word of God. Alright, let's go a bit further. Right? So, what is the dilemma? What a dilemma. To speak or not to speak, that is the question. Right? If we were to stop right here, I believe we would have a torrent of opinions about the subject. However, neither James nor Paul ceased to write about the subject. I like that. They had a spiritual mind. They had the Holy Spirit. They were writing the epistles under the influence and the power of the Holy Spirit. Every word of God was inspired by the Spirit. The Spirit did not stop there. Are you with me? That means there is hope for every one of us who are democratic in our thinking, who have got freedom of speech and freedom of religion. So we must know how to speak, when to speak, what to speak that will glorify Yeshua. Am I right? All right. So, James or Paul never ceased to write about the subject. James continues on to make the statement in verse 8, but no man can tame the tongue. It is important to note that he declares that no man can accomplish this feat. He does not say that the Spirit of God residing within a man cannot tame your tongue. He did not say that. But he said no man. That means a man in his all his understanding and in all his education and in all his status in the society does not have the power to tame his own tongue. That's what he's saying. That means it is beyond the power of man to tame his own very tongue, because the Bible says it is full of iniquity and it has been plucked into hell. Right? So let's go further. To the contrary, Paul is very clear as to where our assistance will come, as noted in verse 5. Our assistance, he says in verse 5, but according to his mercy. I like that word. By the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Spirit. I mean, ponder on these three words. What does the Holy Spirit do? I like that. When you are water baptized and Holy Spirit filled, the Holy Spirit immediately is activated to help you make decisions for Jesus. The Holy Spirit's job is to write the Torah in the tablet of your heart. The Holy Spirit's responsibility is that He, along with your human nature, will work tandemly, simultaneously, in refining you, glorifying you, sanctifying you, and making you holy, so that you will be acceptable in the presence of Yeshua. So if you see the first word, washing, the first word washing in that particular passage of scripture comes from the Greek word lutron, which means literally to give a bath. I like that. When a baby is born, what do? My sons were born in my arms. For one fellow, I cut the umbilical cord, he's sitting there behind the boat. And so very tough. Are you with me? And they both were there. I cut the cord. Man, amazing feeling. Doctors and nurses know that. But I had the opportunity to know myself personally. Praise God for that. And I know the moment the child is born, he's dirty. Full of the amniotic fluid and blood and muck. Are you with me? So what do the doctors do? They put first thing into his nostrils. The moment they cut the umbilical cord, clean his nostrils because full of goo. Are you with me? Why? So that his pipe will be clear so he can take his first breath and breathe. My dear brothers and sisters, when you were born again, God did the same thing by the power of the Holy Spirit. He gave you the power to breathe the life of Yeshua. He cleaned you, that muck inside of you. He poured his blood and cleansed you from inside and gave the very first breath of life. That you can breathe a holy breath and have a conscious awareness that now you are born again in the kingdom of Yeshua. Hallelujah. Your born again experience is not an ordinary experience. Your born again experience is a powerful experience that a man undergoes for him to know that God is at work in his life. The very first breath. After that, what do the doctors do? This guy now, he may be crying, but he gets a nice hose wash. Are you with me? He's given a bath. The midwife will take the baby and will start giving him a bath, and they'll hold him like nothing has happened. And he becomes so beautiful and smells so nice. Put a little nappy or no nappy, bring him straight on the mother's breast. That's what God did for you. He washed you in the waters of baptism, brought you into the arms of the Holy Spirit, and kept you at the breast of God. Then you will take of the paths of the Holy Ghost and drink of the milk of Yeshua. You were not born again just like that. You were born again by the Word of God. The incorruptible Word. You became holy. You could hear the first time the heartbeat of God. You knew that you were born in darkness, but now you're born again. You have been put into the nostril, cleansed by the power of the Holy Ghost. born again experience is not ordinary. You're not ordinary. You are so special that God would kill a generation of people to save you. You're so special. So beloved of the Lord. You have drank of the Holy Spirit. You have eaten the drank the milk of the Word. And now you are so seasoned that you're eating the meat of God's Word. That's what God has called you to do. So He washed you. I like that word. Washing comes from the Greek word lutron, literally to give a bath or to immerse in water, such as a baptism. That's why baptism is so critical and important, that you will bury your dead man in the watery grave and allow God's Holy Spirit to bring you into the presence of Yeshua. It is used to describe a ceremonial washing in order to dedicate us, having purified us by the washing of the water by the Word. This tells us that the process starts with the washing or renewing of our minds with the Word of God. It is God's living and active Word, Hebrews 4:12, that ignites the regeneration process in each of us. It is the Word, say the Word. It's the Holy Spirit who has ignited into my life, very new life of Jesus. Hallelujah. The next word is regenerate. First is what?
Washing.
Very attentive man. First word is what? Other on this side, left side?
Washing.
Behind?
Washing.
All right. The second word is what? Regeneration. Focus our attention. It comes from the Greek word paleognesia, and it connotes a rebirth or a spiritual renovation or renewal. We will never control a tongue without the regeneration process initiated and empowered by the Holy Spirit. This is expressed clearly by the use of the next word: washing, regeneration, and then renewing. Let's go to the word renewing. It comes from the Greek word anakinosis, which translates to mean renovation, to cause something to become new and different, with the implication of becoming superior. Wow. Where was your tongue plugged in? To the hell. When Jesus came, He cut the umbilical cord from hell, put in the tube of the Holy Ghost in your nostrils, cleansed you up, gave you a bath of the Holy Ghost, gave you a bath of the Word of God, gave you a bath of the water of the baptism, immersed you in the Holy Ghost, made you pure, and put you in the paps of Jehovah God. Hallelujah. So what God is doing, He is now renewing you every day. You're thinking. As a man thinketh, so is he. And a Christian thinks, not that statement of Isaiah, oh, God's thoughts are high, my thoughts are down. That was Old Testament. Corinthians says what, Brother John? Now I have the mind of Christ in me. Oh. Christ who has conquered hell. Christ who has conquered grave. Christ who has conquered death and is now alive. I have the same mind of Yeshua in me now.
Yes.
Hello?
Yes.
That's what God is doing. That means He is unplugging you from hell and plugging you back to heaven, to the source that gives you life, the current of the Holy Spirit, the power flow of the Holy Fire, that you will no longer thinking of hell, of death or suicide, of depression and disillusionment, but you will be thinking the things of heaven.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
Set not your affection on things below,
yes,
but
things above.
Things above.
Amen.
So what are you doing with God? You are cooperating with the Holy Spirit. He's with you and He's wanting to help you, provided you would allow Him. you willing to allow the Holy Ghost to change you and plug you to the power source of heaven and give you that power flow life down from the heavenly realm, so that you'll be holy, you'll be the child of God, the prophet of God, the minister of God, the worshiper of God, and you will run the race heavenly minded, not hell minded. Come on. That's what God is doing. I like my Jesus. Right? It is the same word that is used in Romans 12 too. But be transformed by the renewal of the mind. So God's Spirit is renewing you. And if you don't give room to the Word, then the world will come. I repeat. If you don't give room to the Word, then the world will come in, whether you like it or not, because you're living in the world. That's why deliberately, what we do, discipleship program. What we do, we learn the Word. We sit at the apostles' feet. Deliberately, we switch off our phones. And we switch off our social media. And we switch off the newspapers of the world. And we get plugged into the Holy Word. And plug ourselves to the Holy Spirit. So that all through the day, I will be refreshed in the presence of the Holy One of Israel. So that I will no longer speak the worldly language. I will speak the word language. The more the word will be out. Yes. Amen. If you want your tongue to stop abusing and cursing and start speaking God's word, then you need to deliberately allow yourself to be saturated with the presence of God. You must allow yourself to keep speaking in tongues in the Holy Spirit. You must allow yourself to read the word, to study the word, to assimilate God's word. So no matter which situation you are in, you will be speaking God's word even though you feel sick, even though you feel down and out. Why aren't you downcast, O my soul? Put your hope in God, put your trust in God. That's what David was saying. When he was running away for his life, he was hiding in the caves of Adullam and Engedi. He was trusting in his God. When Paul was in the prison, he could write a freedom letter to the free church outside, though he was in darkness and dungeon. Why? Your circumstances does not define the mental status that you have of eternity. Are you with me? Ask those martyrs who are willing to die for Jesus. They have only seen Jesus. Ask Stephen, when he was stoned to death by the Jewish people, he saw Jesus standing. Hallelujah. In times of your persecution, in times of your pain, in times of your sorrow, in times of your lack, in times of your sickness, if your mind is so set on heaven, then those circumstantial evidences will not drown you but lift you. You know why? Because you're so heavenly minded and so eternally focused that the things of this world doesn't drown you. The things of this world become barren to you. You float on it. Hallelujah. Because the man who floats on the water is looking heavenwards. A man who drowns, he cries for help. But a man who floats, you're floating on the worldly waters but looking up to heaven. That's your scenario and that's your picture as a living person and a living saint of Yeshua the Messiah. God is calling. Hallelujah. So Paul's statement here makes it very clear that the process and the empowerment to control the tongue comes about only from the Holy Ghost. That is why you and I need the Holy Ghost every day. Every day. An infilling of the Holy Ghost every day. Your children must be filled with the Holy Ghost every day. Not that when some program happens and you got filled. You danced and came and then now you started to dance for the world. No, no, no. You're dancing for Jesus forever. Every day is a party day. Every day is a party time. You know why? Because I have party irrespective of the circumstances. It doesn't matter what's happening around me. It matters what is happening with me and my God. If what is happening with me and my God is right and grace and righteous, man, it's a party time every day. It's a joyous time. It's a fun time. It's a game time. It's a fellowship time. It's a biryani time. his fullness. And the joy of the Lord is my strength. The kingdom of God is what? Righteousness, peace, and joy of the Holy Spirit. So I enjoy it every day. And God wants you to enjoy it every day. The kingdom of God. Say, the kingdom of God is in my heart. The kingdom of God is in my mind. The kingdom of God is in my mouth. Amen. For a saint of God, the kingdom is within you. It's not somewhere elsewhere. It's not far-fetched. The kingdom is within you. As a man thinketh, so is he. Are you thinking heaven? Are you thinking millennium? Are you thinking to live long? Are you living, thinking to live strong? If you're living, thinking to live strong, you will be strong. Why? Because out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh. If your heart is filled with the word, then Zion, you will be speaking the word. Amen. The Bible says in the book of Psalms, open your mouth wide and I will fill it. Yes. You go to Dr. Julius, he also says the same thing. Open your mouth wide and I will fill it. You go to Dr. Jesus or you go to Dr. Julius, they both will tell you, open your mouth wide and I will fill it. If you want to get filled with the Holy Ghost, go to Jesus. If you want to get filled with gold and silver, go to Dr. Judas. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. So this brings us to this point. Jesus was very outspoken when it came to matters about unrighteousness and the flaunting of sin. It made no difference as to who or whom if it was challenging God's standard for life. Are you with me?
Amen.
Jesus denounced sin.
Amen.
And therefore you need Moses as your pastor.
Yes.
God softens in Aaron as your pastor. You need Moses.
Hallelujah.
Who will roar at you.
Yes.
And get angry with you at times.
Yes.
Because you have sinned.
Yes.
And your Moses today is Jesus.
Amen. Yes.
He loves you. He does not allow bastards to be in his kingdom.
Amen. Yes.
Because you are not bastards.
Yes.
You're born of the legitimate,
yes,
incorruptible,
yes,
word of Yeshua.
Yes.
You're born again into,
yes,
his kingdom.
Yes.
Your thinking has changed.
Amen.
Your heart has changed.
Amen.
The three battleground that the enemy wanted to have rule and reign is now the kingdom of,
yes,
Yeshua.
Yeah.
The heart that belonged to the devil is now,
amen,
belongs to Jesus. The mind that was thinking lustful things is now thinking the word.
Yes.
The mouth that was speaking cuss words is now speaking,
yes,
blessing words.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
Is now speaking in tongues and now prophesying. Yes. Is now worshiping. Is now glorifying.
Yes.
Is now praising the name of Yeshua. There is no cuss word.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Abraham said, I will bless you, and in you all the families of the earth will be blessed.
Yes, yes, yes.
I want to say the same thing. Lord, you blessed Abraham, I'm blessed in Abraham.
Yes.
And through me, all the nations of the earth must be blessed.
Yes.
My wife should be blessed, my children should be blessed, my relatives should be blessed, my church should be blessed, my job should be blessed, my business should be blessed, my community should be blessed. Everywhere there should be a blessing.
Yes.
See, I'm a blessing. My dear brothers and sisters, the Holy Spirit is here with you right now. He's working with you. Don't ignore the prompting of the Holy Spirit. Allow Him to change. Allow Him to transform you. His one work is to renew your thinking. If two of you agree, whatever you shall ask, it shall be given to you.
Yes.
Who's the two of you? In prison, for Paul, who is the two of you? You are a tripartite being. You have a spirit, you have a coconut, that is the soul, and you live in the strength of the body.
If you are in prison and Amazing Grace Church is not there for you, then who's going to pray with you? Your spirit and your soul. Two of you agree on anything. Whatever you will ask, it shall be given unto you. Let your spirit and your soul agree to the word of God. It's only 1 foot away. From heart to your coconut is how many distance of this? 1 foot, 12 inch, across, depending on the size of it. Right. Almost 12 inch. From here to here. Correct? Bring that to alignment. Make it godly. Make it holy. Make it righteous. And whatever you speak, it will be done. Believe it in your heart. And God will make it happen. No one knew the nature of the tongue more than King David when he wrote in Psalms 141, 3 and 4. And he says, set a guard, O Lord, over my mouth. Keep watch over the door of my lips. Do not incline my heart. What? Why is David saying that? Set a guard, O Lord. Guard. Right? Wasn't David democratic? He enjoyed freedom than anyone else. Of us. Are you with me? But he's saying, God set a guard over my mouth. That's what he's saying. Keep watch over the door of my lips. The door of your lips. And then he says, do not incline my heart to any evil thing, to practice wicked works with men who work iniquity, and do not let me eat of the delicacies. Whoa. He was not willing to sell his birthright like he saw. Pot or porridge. In Psalm 17, 1 to 4, he says, hear the right, O Lord, attend unto my cry, give ear unto my prayer, that goeth not out of feigned lips. Other translation says, deceitful lips. He's saying, and mind you, the Holy Ghost was not living inside of him, it was only upon him. The Holy Ghost was only upon him. He had the unction and the aura of the Holy Ghost. But he was not baptized in the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit was not yet living inside of him, because Jesus had not yet come and died and buried and resurrected for the Holy Ghost to come and live within him. But yet he speaks those words. Let my sentence, he says, come forth from your presence. I like that. That means God trained me so much that when I speak, I will speak the oracles of him. Whoa. No cuss word, no negative word, no discouraging words. Build that in other words. Build yourself in the most holy faith. Praying in the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
Right? Let my sentence come forth from your presence. Let thine eyes behold the things that are equal. Thou hast proved mine heart. Thou hast visited me in the night. Thou hast tried me and shalt find zero. Nothing. I like that. Can you imagine the audacity, the boldness of David to say, God, try me and you'll find me holy. And mind you, he was in that era when the Holy Ghost was not yet living inside of him. But he had the audacity and the boldness to say, God, test me and you'll find no evil in me. I'm pure and I'm holy. Amazing. Wow. Then he says, thou hast proved mine heart, thou hast visited me in the night, thou hast tried me and shall find nothing. I am purposed that my mouth shall not.
Yes. Hallelujah.
What are you saying? I am purposed. That means I have made a determination. I have made up my mind that my mouth will not speak evil.
Yes.
That's what he's saying.
Yes.
You cannot become David king like that. If you have to be king and priests, exercise what David was doing.
Yes.
Then he says, concerning the works of men, by the word of your lips, I have kept me from the paths of the destroyer.
Mm-hmm.
How did David keep himself from the enemy? By the words of Jesus. By the words of Jehovah God. If you want to keep yourself from every harm and every evil and every bullet that is flying and every accident that's taking in the Dubai roads and every evil that is befalling on the people of the world, you must be governed by the holy, incorruptible word of Yeshua Messiah. Fill yourself, saturate yourself, immerse yourself, pickle yourself in the Holy Ghost. Come on,
pickle yourself in the masala of the word. Come on, become tasty and pleasurable and glorious to Yeshua. Let God delight in you. Let God take pleasure upon you. Let God say, you are mine and I'm yours. And the banner over you is mine. Why did David seek God's assistance to guard his mouth? Because your words are seeds. Amen. Mark 4. And whatever seed you will sow will produce a harvest after its own. That's why God is reminding through the Pauline letters to the church, guard your tongue, guard your mouth, guard your heart, guard your mind, be holy, speak the word, and when you speak the word, I will stand behind my word to make it happen. Amen. Yeah. Galatians chapter 6, verses 7 to 8 is reiterated the same thing. Paul is reiterating what was written in Genesis 1, 20 to 31. The harvest time and the seed time and the sowing time remains the same. As long as the earth will, the seasons will remain. Seed time and harvest time will remain. Your words, the book of Mark chapter 4 says, is like seeds. How you will invest, how you sow it, you will reap the benefit. The Bible says, do not be deceived. God is not mocked. For whatever man sows, that he shall also will reap. For he who sows to his flesh will of the flesh reap corruption, but he who sows to the Spirit will of the Spirit reap everlasting life. We are the people of everlasting life. Amen. Let's all rise in the presence of God. Come on. The question is, what kind of a harvest you are reaping today? What kind of a harvest you are reaping today? Are you speaking the word language that says there is downturn of economy? Are you speaking the world language that there is bird flu outside? Or chikungunya? Are you speaking the world language that the Wall Street is collapsing and tomorrow nuclear war is going to take place? Well, that will happen in the future, that's fine. Because perilous days are coming. What are you confessing? What are you seeing? Are you seeing disaster for your life? Or you're seeing prosperity for your life? Are you seeing hell in your life? Or do you see heaven in your life? Do you see sickness in your body? Or you do see yourself in total health and strength in Jesus' name? It's a question that we need to ask ourselves. What are we speaking today? What is the heart filled with? Is it filled with lust of the world? Or it is filled with the word of Yeshua? Whatever it is filled with, you will be governed with. So if you want to be governed with heaven, fill yourself with the word Yeshua. Fill your mind with word Yeshua. Fill your mouth with word Yeshua. Fill your heart with the word of God. Exercise your senses. Become so trained in Jesus that you will not speak anything of your own. You will speak the oracles of God. The Bible says in the book of Isaiah chapter 58, which is a fasting chapter, but in the end portion of 13, 14, 15, 16, it very clearly says, if you honor the Sabbath and do not speak your words, but speak God's words. Very clearly written. Don't speak your words. Speak God's words. And if you honor the Sabbath and keep the Sabbath, I will bless you. I will feed you with the heritage of Jacob. And I will cause you to ride on the high places of the earth. I like that scripture. God is saying, I will help you do that. If you do this, that means we will cooperate with the Holy Spirit today and say, God, here am I. Please forgive me. If my tongue was plucked to hell, you have, Lord, circumcised me. You have cut that umbilical cord. You have made me a born-again believer of Yeshua. You have gone through the waters of baptism. You have given me a bath, oh Lord, with your word and with your spirit. You have regenerated me. You have renewed me, oh God. Make me like you. Make me whole. Make me pure. And God will make you. God will honor you. Because he loves you. He loves you. The Bible says in the book of Romans, he says, if he did not spare his own son, how much more will he not give all things freely to them? Those who ask him. Ask for him. Don't ask your pastor. Don't ask your admin leader. Ask Jesus. He's your Moses. He
loves you. He died for you on the cross of Calvary. If you're grappling with your mental thoughts, that is evil. If you're grappling with your mouth that speaks curse words, no. The power is within you. Romans 10 verse 8 says, the word is near you. The word of faith that we have preached is near you. It's inside your heart. That if you will confess with your mouth that Jesus was born. If you confess Jesus, you will be saved. If you believe in your heart that Jesus was raised up from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart a man believes, but with the mouth a man makes confession unto salvation. Your salvation is to you right here. Let all eyes be closed. Let all head be bowed. This is a very, very, very serious matter. For every one of us. For all of us. You may be a man given to anger, and you say, God, in my anger, I curse my children. In my anger, I've spoken rudely to my wife. In my anger, oh Lord, I've spoken against my manager. Please forgive me. A serious man. Lord, I was angry. I spoke certain things that was not right. I've blown a hole in my salvation. And I don't see peace in my heart. And I don't see joy in my workplace. And I don't see righteousness in my family. Come on. This word is for all of us. We Christians. When Paul was writing to Titus, he was writing to the church. Every Pauline letter was written to the church that were walking in faithfulness to Yeshua. Jesus loves you, church. More than your pastor, he loves you. More than the elders of this church, Jesus loves you. I promise you that. His love will never fail for you. My love as a pastor can fail and may fail. But his love is eternal. He has loved you with an everlasting love. He will never forsake you. He will never leave you. He will never start a work in you and leave you in the middle of the ocean. No, sir. He will take you to the other side. He will take you to the other side. Because he loves you. Because he cares about you. Because the Holy Ghost has taken you and put you in the breast of Jehovah God. That you'll become a holy girdle. The girdle of God that is holy is the church of Jesus. That is woven with the golden thread is the church of Jesus. With those precious stones which is on the outer robe of the priest is the church of Jesus. It's nobody else, it's you. You are so precious and so highly valuable to God that he has caused you to cling to his breast. You are the holy girdle of Yeshua. If Yeshua is the high priest of your salvation, you are the holy girdle of that salvation. He bears you to display the glory of the word. These are mine. Amazing grace, church is mine. These are my people, bought by my blood, filled by me with my Holy Spirit. These are mine. And I wear them to display the girdle of God, the holy girdle of God. That's what Revelation talks about. When you see Yeshua, he's wearing the girdle of God. The girdle is nobody else but the church. He's so precious. When you hear the heartbeat of God, you will hear when it beats faster or when it beats slower. Is there any anxiety in the heartbeat of God? No. He doesn't get anxious. He's not fearful. Everything is in his control. Everything is in divine order in his eyes. His heart doesn't beat a step faster. An even heart. Come to me, all you heavy burdens, and laden with care, I will give you rest. Come to me. In your strength, you have struggled. In your strength, you have struggled to be holy. No. God is saying, don't struggle to be holy. Come to me, and I will make you holy. That's what God is saying. No mother God or goddesses of this world will never give you the guarantee that Jesus gives. Come to me and I will make you holy.
Yes.
I like that. Because when I was in the Lord, I was struggling to be holy. The lust of the flesh, evil thoughts, evil eyes, evil mouth, cursed words, anger, fight. That's how my life was. But the more I grow closer to the Lord, Lord, remove everything. Delivered me from my sins. Delivered me from my chains and my fetters and my bondages. Delivered me and make me whole, make me pure, make me righteous. And He's still working in me. And He's working in you alone. As we are in an attitude of prayer, is there anybody in our midst who want to make Jesus as Lord? You may be here for the very first time, and you said, this is the condition of the world. My life is plugged in hell, but I want to experience heaven. Today is the day of your salvation. Today, if you will believe in your heart and confess with your mouth that Jesus Christ is the Lord of your life, that Jesus died for his sin, was buried, and was resurrected by the power of the Holy Spirit, you will be saved. Today is your day. Today is your day. If there is anybody in our midst where all heads are bowed and all eyes are closed, you are introspecting your life in the presence of the Word of God, in the presence of Jesus. Will there be anybody in our midst who's not yet a Christian, who's not yet a disciple of Jesus, and you want to become a disciple of Jesus? You want your sins to be forgiven. You want your name to be written in the book of life with Jesus Christ, your name, that you will become the Son of God. If there's anybody in our midst wants to make Jesus as Lord, today is your day. You can raise up your right hand wherever you are, and I'm going to pray with you wherever you are. Don't be ashamed at all. Your life was in turmoil, in trouble, but you want Jesus. God bless you, my brother. Anybody else? Anybody else? Jesus loves you. I told you more than your pastor. Jesus loves you. I did not die for your sins. Jesus died for your sins. God bless you, brother. Anybody else? Anybody else who wants to be Jesus as Lord? You have not yet become a disciple of Jesus, but from today onwards, you want to make Jesus your Lord. Father, I thank you for these two hands that went up. You have seen them. You love them. You honor them. Make them your own. Deliver them from all their bondages. Plug them in to heaven. Plug them in into the book of life. Plug them in into the Holy Spirit. Plug them in into the Word of God. That henceforth the life of hell will be changed and become a life of heaven. In Jesus' name. I pray that the sins will be forgiven. I pray that, Lord, you will make them your own. I pray that you will bless them. And you will welcome them into your kingdom. Bless them. Because they are yours. In Jesus' name. Amen. And speak to those people. You are the disciples of Jesus. But somewhere, down the line, there is corruption in your speech. Some of your speech does not sound holy. Some of your tongue is blurry and slurry. Some of your tongue slips and uses those curse words. And I'm talking to the church today. And a lot of time you open the door because of your tongue for Satan to come in and eat of your prosperity, of your health, of your wealth, of your finances, of your future, of your men.
that is you, repent. If that is you, say, God, forgive me of the slur of speech, of the tone of speech, of the art of communication that I have not yet learned. Please forgive me, teach me, Lord. Come on, this is for the church. I don't want any hands going up. You with Jesus, I with Jesus, because He is my good shepherd, He is your good shepherd. We can reconcile. He said, God, forgive me. We have an advocate in heaven, Jesus, who will represent you correctly before your judge, the Jehovah God. Because, my dear brothers and sisters, on the judgment day, by your words, you and I will be judged. By your words, you and I will be judged. The Bible says in the book of Matthew, chapter 12, verse 36, Jesus says, and I say unto you that every idle word that man shall speak, that men shall speak, they shall give account thereof in the day of judgment. And Jesus did not say abusive word, and Jesus did not say evil word, but He said idle word. You know, the standards of Jesus is way superior than the world's standards. And He's not talking about evil words or curse words. He's talking idle words, casual speech. Jesus is talking about casual speech with the church. We will be judged because of our casual speech. My dear brothers and sisters, when I stand before the judgment seat of God, my prayer is, of God, I want to hear one voice. Well done, my good and faithful servant, enter into your rest. When I want to talk about you, I want to talk good about you. When I want to think about you, I want to think good about you. Because I know the potential that God has placed within you. He has put in His Word and He has put in His Holy Spirit. And church, the Holy Spirit is reminding, Jesus is coming soon. And if He's coming soon, we the church must be ready. He's coming for a church that is prepared, ready, with oil in our lamps, with light in our lamps, waiting for our bridegroom. I want us to be ready. I want us to be ready in Jesus' name. Speak any idle word that on that day of judgment can go against me. Fill your account in heaven with good words, with godly words, with righteous words, with holy words, with blessing. It is the blessing of the Lord that makes you rich. Bless your wife, bless your children, bless your pastors, bless your elders, bless your church. Bless your community. Bless the Prime Minister. Bless the President. Bless the rulers of the earth. Every authority has been placed by God. Bless your manager at workplace. Bless your CEO. Bless your general manager. Come on. That's what God is calling. Yes, you have the freedom of speech and the right to speak the way you want to speak, but no, sir. As Christians, I have the freedom of what I ought to speak within the parameters of Yeshua's word. That will build, that will encourage, that will solidify, that will speak the word of Yeshua. Speak life. Jesus said, the words that I speak to you, they are spirit and they are life. Jesus doesn't condemn you. Jesus doesn't derogate you. Jesus doesn't curse you. Jesus only says, I want to bless Amazing Grace Church. Every member, every brother,
and every sister.
I want to bless. I will bless them. I will bless them. I will build them. I will make them. I will prosper them. I will flourish them. I will heal them. I will deliver them.
That's what he's saying. That's what Jesus is saying about you. Are you in trouble? Come to me. I will give you relief. Are you heavy laden? Come to me and I will give you rest. That's what Jesus is saying. Jesus is not saying any words that is worldly, but Jesus is saying, come to me, all ye heavy burdened, and I will give you rest. There remains the rest for the people of God to enter. And he who has believed has already entered into his rest. We are believers. Father, in the name of Jesus, I release your anointing of your word to your people. These are your people. Come on, let's raise our hands up to heaven. I'm releasing God's anointing upon you. And receive it, catch it, grab it. Father, release your anointing. I release your holiness. I release your righteousness. I release your peace. I release your joy upon your people in the name of Jesus. Lord, I declare that the kingdom of God has now become the kingdom of his people. I declare, O Lord, that every sickness must flee from the church in Jesus' name. And I declare that your church will be healed and made whole by the power of God's Spirit in the name of Jesus. Every disease, I take authority over you and I cast you out. Get out in Jesus' name. Every financial lack, every spirit of poverty, I bind you, I rebuke you, and I chuck you out from this church in the name of Jesus. Satan, you've got no right to touch God's people. These are holy people of God. These are blood-bought people of God. These are washed people of God. They are the righteousness of God. And Satan, I remind you, your place is in hell. In the pit, not amongst the saints of God. Leave and go in Jesus' name. I release jobs for your people. I release business deals for your people. I release blessed marriages for your people. I release functional families for Jesus. I declare divine order in the lives of your people. From the crown of their head to the soles of their feet, I declare order in Jesus' name. Order in their marriage. Order in their families. Order in their finances. Order in their future. Order in their destiny. Order in their community. Order in their workplaces. Order in their businesses. Order in every realm of the living. In Jesus' name. For you are not an author of confusion, but you are an author of faith, author of order, author of good governance. Let there be good governance upon your church, that they will walk in the favor of God, in the blessing of God, in the blessings of Abraham, in the blessings of Jehovah, Yeshua, in Jesus' name. The work of the hands will flourish and prosper. That the world will say and say, they are blessed of the Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Because you have blessed. I thank you and I bless you. I pray that your word will take root in our hearts. We'll be grounded and rooted in your word. No matter what storm comes, we shall not be uprooted. We will stand firm and we will see the glory of the living God. We thank you. We bless you and we give you the praise. In Jesus' most holy, mighty, and matchless name we pray. Amen. Now the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of the Father, and the fellowship of his sweet Holy Spirit be with us now and forevermore. And all the saints of God said, Amen. 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 Give the Lord a big hand.